night on world's worst storms. Hurricane Sandy devastates a coastal community in New York.
I thought my parents were dead.
In Illinois.
It's coming toward us.
Get in the house.
A tornado tears a peaceful neighborhood to pieces.
I've seen something amazing that almost killed me.
A boating family are battered by Hurricane Ivan.
It was alive and malevolent.
And in Oklahoma, a Force 5 tornado rips through a school full of children.
I've never been so frightened in my whole life.
Created when a center of low pressure develops with a high pressure system surrounding it, storms can cause chaos with high winds, rain, and flooding.
Back porch.
From thunder and lightning to tornadoes and hurricanes, they can impact on human life when we least expect it, with devastating consequences.
You never expect to go to the state fair and have something like that happen.
The Indiana State Fair has been held in Indianapolis for more than a century. Local resident David Wood has been coming to the fair his whole life.
I remember going as a young kid, and you know, with my mother, and we would go once or twice a year, but now that I've started my own family, we try to go several times. They usually have, you know, two or three good headliners there to play each year. In 2011, we went to the fair that evening to celebrate my wife's birthday. I got us the pit ticket so we could be as close as we could to the bands. Just wanting to see a big smile on her face when, you know, she was 5-10 feet away from her favorite, you know, band at the time.
Also at the concert that night was photographer Jessica Silas.
I had gone the previous year with my parents. They wanted to try and make it kind of a yearly tradition, so I bought tickets again to go to a country concert.
Unlike David, Jessica had gone for the cheaper seats in the sheltered grandstand away from the stage.
My mom was really happy with our seats because I knew that there was a chance of severe storms that they were predicting later in the day. And she was saying how happy she was that we got like the cheap seats.
At 8:39 p.m., just 6 minutes before the headline act was due to go on stage, the National Weather Service issued a severe thunderstorm warning for the area.
I was taking a lot of pictures of the storm approaching from the west, and it was just crazy how bright it was in the east, and then you turn and look in the west and it was pitch black. It was the most drastic change in color in the sky, light to dark, that I've ever seen. And you could just see that something was coming.
We didn't think it was going to be too bad since they still had, you know, stage crew up in the rigging to control the lighting. So we figured the show was going to go on, you know, rain or shine. And then boom, it's right above you.
The wind, it definitely came out of nowhere. It was just all of a sudden, just wind, a huge, huge gust of wind. It was painful because it was all the sand and dust and it was hitting us in the face, and people started screaming and pointing at it just because it was so out of nowhere.
Heard all the metal clanking and seeing the screen going back and forth and swaying around. But we planned on, you know, waiting it out to hold our good spot because we knew if we went and stood under the grandstands until it passed, we probably wasn't going to get our prime location back. I pulled out the phone to start recording, then it seemed like a bigger blast came in and got all up under the stage equipment and the awning. At that moment, that's when I realized, you know, things were turning for the worst.
I kind of saw out of the corner of my eye the tarp on the top of the stage. It kind of came loose and it was flapping around, because I thought that was kind of weird.
I grabbed my wife by her arm and turned her and started pushing her in the back. You had people pushing on you, trying to get in front of you, and then you could look up in the eyes of the people in the grandstands, and you just knew what was behind you wasn't right. It was like being chased by a beast of some sort.
The stage started to lean, and then it just completely folded on itself. was almost like a movie. It doesn't seem real because you just don't think that that can actually happen.
The strong winds had shifted concrete barriers used to anchor the stage rigging, causing the 32-ton structure to collapse. Narrowly missing David and his wife.
Oh my God!
It was like you felt the pressure of, you know, all the equipment and the weight coming at you. It was like it was making its own gust of wind. I turn and look behind, and the top of the stage was probably about 10 feet from us.
Are you okay? Oh, God!
You kind of had people there just in shock, you know, holding their head, and you tell people we're looking for friends and family members. You heard screams from under there of people that needed help and wanted out.
Oh, my God!
It was just an instinct to jump back in and you know, follow the sounds and help who needed help.
It was chaos. I mean, people were screaming, hands over their mouths. Oh my God, oh my God. I mean, you never expect to go to a concert or at the state fair and have something like that happen. You just don't, you never think that.
People laying around hollering for help. You got people crawling and trying to get to others. It was just chaos.
It's not moving. Calm down. Where's she bleeding from?
I heard a lady, you know, screaming for help, help. And I seen blood all over her. And I initially thought, you know, she had a gash in her head or something. But it was her young daughter that was in her arm. I see her holding her arm, you know, close to her body and up toward the shoulder. There's this open gash wound. I knew to take my shirt off, and I was trying to wedge that between her body and her arm to tie it off and stop the bleeding.
Hey, we need a medic really bad for this little girl. Right here. Right here. I just gave her my shirt for a tourniquet.
I'm a doctor.
It's breaking. Come on, sir.
We got
a doctor. Watch out. We got a doctor.
3-year-old Maggie Mullin was taken to hospital, where surgeons battled to save her arm. Thankfully, she made a full recovery, though others at the fairground weren't so lucky.
My dad, he's a doctor, so he ran down to help people that had gotten trapped underneath. And he said that he had seen people who had died, and there were definitely fatalities that had happened.
5 people were pronounced dead at the scene. 2 more died later in hospital. Over 40 people suffered serious injuries.
You know, we got there early to try to get the best location we could, and while we were standing in line, kind of made friends with a couple, her and her partner, and, you know, had good conversations with them. And then a few days later on the news, come to find out that she was one of the ones that passed away. That could have easily been one of us that, you know, got hit in the head or knocked out or trapped and, you know, killed under there also. And that's when it really sunk in. We were very, very lucky.
Coming up on World's Worst Storms, Hurricane Katrina rips the soul from New Orleans.
When it starts breaking houses away from their foundation, you know that's bad.
And a school in Oklahoma is ripped to pieces by a maximum force tornado as the children and teachers inside fear for their lives.
I totally lost it.
Tornadoes are amongst the most powerful storms on Earth. When warm air from the ground rises and meets the cold air above, downward funnels are created, causing wind speeds of up to 300 miles per hour. In May 2013, Moore in Oklahoma was hit by one of the most destructive and violent tornadoes in U.S. history.
I've never been so frightened in my life.
School teacher Robin Dieksik was at Briarwood Elementary with her class on that fateful day.
the day before there were some pretty bad storms in the area. I think that the community was a little bit on heightened awareness because of that. And so when Monday rolled around, as I was getting ready for work, I had the news on like I always do, and I halfway heard the weatherman say to be weather aware that day, that some more storms were moving into the area.
What Robin didn't know was that a mass of air southwest of the city was forming into a tornado.
So I was standing up teaching in front of my class when our principal announced that we were going to go into our tornado safety precautions. And I said, guys, you have nothing to worry about. I'm their mom when they're not with their mom.
As the storm approaches her school, Robin prepares her students for the worst.
And I said, listen, if it gets serious, you better have your head tucked. Protect your head with the back of your hands. We were in that position for a little while when one of our teachers yelled, get in the bathrooms.
Sit down right out here.
It had gone from precautionary to it's going to go overhead.
Sit down right here.
The approaching tornado is caught on camera two streets away by Charles Gafford, who takes refuge in a storm shelter.
You just kind of watch this cloud start from here, and then eventually it's that big, and then that big, and then the next thing you know, there's 2x4s falling 20 feet away from you.
The tornado is a force 5 on the Fujita scale, the highest measurable intensity, causing winds of over 200 miles per hour.
The roar is something that grows very gradually, but it becomes so intimidating when it's close to you, it's overbearing.
It's okay.
Robin and her students are inside the school bathroom when the tornado passes over.
It was a very surreal, random, large pelting.
Oh my God, I hate this!
I know, it's okay, honey.
Oh, it's
okay. It's okay.
And it just kept amping up and amping up and amping up.
It's all my fault. I'm so sorry, Rachel.
I had maintained control. I had thought probably nothing is going to happen. And at that point, it ripped overhead. I've never been so frightened in my whole life. I totally lost it, and I wasn't the teacher in control at that moment.
Charles is hiding out virtually opposite the school as the tornado hits the area with full force.
The house that I was filming was still standing. But there were some houses that were parallel, even on our side of the street, that had been completely lifted up. That kind of leads to the school that was directly across the street from us, and that there's not an underground storm shelter for them. It's really just brick walls, and when you have an F5 tornado, those don't stand up against anything.
As Robin and her students shelter in the bathroom, their school is ripped to shreds by the 200 mile per hour winds.
I was listening and I thought I could hear it lessening, and we were still there. There was still a roof over our heads.
You okay?
Yeah.
She's a very experienced.
It's okay.
None of us have.
I was very relieved that we were still there, and we shook off what was on us, and we stood up and we went out into the hall.
Wow. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God.
It was just, it was a lot to absorb.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God.
The library was nothing but a doorway and sky. The debris marks, it was like things had just been swirling in the hallway.
Oh my God. 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 Oh my God.
I was just getting emotional about what had just happened, and I'm kind of trying to catch my breath and trying to absorb what I'm seeing. And I come back out into the hall, and I'm kind of ready to be teacher again.
Look at me! Sit down right here where you are safe and you are dry!
Most of them are hysterical and crying and looking around and trying to absorb what they're seeing. We decided to take the kids outside, and then it was a whole nother area of things to just absorb.
Oh my God, I can't even recognize it.
When we walked out, there was a parking lot that had 65 cars. It was just swept clean. There were weird gusts of warm and cold air. The sky still looked pretty scary. For miles, all you could see, it looked like there was nothing taller than 2 feet. It was just matchsticks. I mean, the fact that no students were killed in our building is just amazing.
Fifth graders, let's all hug. It's okay, we're so lucky. No one is hurt, we're so lucky, it's fine.
Elsewhere, 24 people had been killed, nearly 400 injured, and over 1,000 buildings damaged or destroyed. Among the dead were 7 children from Plaza Towers Elementary, just over a mile away from Robin's own school.
It was these steps of realizing how serious it was, how lucky we were, how close we came to losing life in that building, how easily one of our kids could have been knocked out by a brick or crushed.
402, my classroom. This is the breezeway. The awning is gone. This is our office.
We didn't do anything special that school family at Plaza Towers didn't do. It's just, it was a monster storm, and if you were not in the right spot right at that moment, there's nothing you could do.
I wasn't even worried about dying.
Hurricane Katrina hit the southern USA in late August 2005. After a 7-day wrecking spree, over 1,800 lives have been lost. The worst affected areas were the city of New Orleans and the counties surrounding it. Former Merchant Marine Kenard Jackley and his wife Dookie have lived in the town of Slidell since 1973. They've experienced their fair share of hurricanes, and when they heard Katrina was coming, she decided to get out, whilst he decided to stay.
I don't ever have to worry about Kennard. He's extremely creative, and he's intuitive. He knows what to do.
Dying don't mean nothing to me. Hell, 30 years at sea, I should have been dead a long time ago.
As Kennard's wife, Dookie, and another 250,000 people pack up and leave New Orleans, the approaching storm rapidly intensifies while entering the Gulf of Mexico. For thousands of people who aren't able to leave, an emergency shelter is set up in the New Orleans Superdome, a football stadium in the middle of the city.
We are very grateful for the Superdome to allow
Nearly 20,000 people move in as the storm approaches, while 70-year-old Kennard beds in to brave the elements.
I think we're here it comes. We just had a gust of about 100 miles an hour just a little while ago.
Within hours, Katrina hits the coastline and the conditions become even more challenging.
Hey, look at this. I don't know what to tell you. Man, you're killing me here. You're killing me.
Storm surge raises sea levels up to 6 feet higher than normal.
Hold downstairs is underwater. My truck's right down there someplace underwater. And then the next thing you know, it was covering the street. And then a little bit higher, a little bit higher. We definitely got a mess downstairs, that's for sure. Okay, oops, we're going to the floor again.
500 miles away at her sister's house in Dallas, Dookie watches the hurricane on TV and fears the worst.
They were talking about, you know, the height of the water, the storm surge, how strong it was, you know, how areas were totally devastated.
Nothing but junk now. Unbelievable.
I just thought it was totally washed away, which it was. And I, you know, I didn't see how he could have survived.
Oh, God, baby. And then the rain came and the wind came. That's when everything hit the fan. Man, this place is devastated out here. Woo! It must have been 100 mile an hour winds, you know. That's how I look at all them houses are gone. When it starts breaking houses away from their foundation, you know that's bad. Pine trees are falling, boathouse disappears, 8 houses behind me disappeared. I mean, it just picked up off the foundation and floated right down the canal back here. Yeah, it's on the back porch. I guess the only good thing you can say about this thing, I don't see no floating bodies yet. Yeah, there wasn't nothing you could do. I guess you could pray a little bit. I don't know for sure. Right? Nah. You're up to the elements. That's all there is to it, you know.
Katrina batters New Orleans for hours. Even those sheltering in the mighty Superdome fear for their safety.
See that water dropping right there? We have rainwater in the building.
The Mississippi River breaches its levees, flooding most of the city, causing over 700 deaths.
Out of my stomach, I thought for sure that he was dead. Plain and simple, yes, I thought he was gone.
I wasn't even worried about dying. That's for true, I'm not kidding.
Well, this is the day after. Take a look at our front yard.
It breaks your heart, man. I mean, it tears you up inside. You don't want to look at your neighborhood and see nothing but chaos. You hate to see anybody lose their world possessions, you know.
You see my truck down there? Yeah, she was a good old girl.
It was 5 days before Kennard was able to contact his wife, who still had no idea if he was dead or alive.
He called me. Oh, my God. That was the happiest day of my life.
Everything's fine out here. So far, so good.
I was on the cell phone in my sister's backyard and just walking around going, ah, it's Kennard, it's Kennard. And everybody was jumping around. We were all happy. Then, you know, you go from that to, damn you. And he even told me that time, I swear I'll never stay again. I'll swear I'll never stay again.
It was another 6 weeks before the couple were reunited, giving Kennard time to fix up the house, although it would take years to rebuild the area around them.
That's a bad thing, man. Mother Nature, she don't ever give nothing back, you know what I mean? She taker. She's a taker. Just like most women.
Coming up on World's Worst Storms, a Force 4 tornado wipes out a family neighborhood in Illinois.
I've seen something amazing that almost killed me.
And Hurricane Sandy brings fire and floods to New York.
I came within 3 minutes of being killed, and there was really nothing I could have done.
Leave that door shut. Get
On the 17th of November 2013, the state of Illinois. Huge and fierce tornado, and roadie Chris Lancaster and his family were caught right at the heart of it.
It's the most amazing thing I've ever saw in my life. Would I want to see it again? No.
Chris lives in the small town of Washington, Illinois, with his wife and family. He loves the town because it is so different to his working life in the world of rock and roll.
I worked with the likes of Jackal, Poison, Quiet Riot, Van Halen. I'm doing shows. I do road management, tour management, sound engineer. Anywhere from 30 weeks a year to 44 weeks a year, 50 weeks a year. But, you know, when I come home, I want to be peaceful.
The day before the tornado hit, Chris was enjoying his break from life on the road, with no idea what was about to happen.
Our high school varsity football team made it to the Final Four, and we all went back to my house, sat in the garage, played cards, 3-4 in the morning, a few of them left, a few of them passed out in the basement. We didn't know nothing about no storms, nowhere.
But while Chris and his buddies slept off their hangovers, a Force 4 tornado was heading towards their town.
My wife wakes me up about, I don't know, 10:30, 10:45. It says sirens are going off, you know, and it's looking a little funky out. It's like it gets real dark, grayish, green looking out. This ain't gonna be nothing. I mean, I'm from the south, I'm used to hurricanes, you know. Another storm, it ain't no big deal. But, you know, as I went out back and just started watching it, and I just saw that one cloud come down and touch ground, and it stayed down. I knew there was something crazy gonna happen.
The tornado is blowing at over 150 miles per hour.
Get in the house! Now! Hurry!
The wife is trying to get me to the basement a few times. She's freaking out.
Chris! It's coming toward us! I'm going with my baby!
Go with the babies! My son comes out. He's been looking at it. And I watched it coming. I'm coming. That thing, that baby was moving.
Oh my God! Holy shit! Look at this, bud! Run with me, okay?
Cars, trucks, motorcycles, houses, what, you name it, was flying. I mean, trees, you watch a tree snap off and then just, it sounds like a freight train coming at you. Whew, it's nuts.
Within moments, the tornado is right next to Chris, who continues filming.
Look at all the roof, bro!
I really don't know what was going through my mind. I was mesmerized by it. They're beautiful, but they're also scary. All of a sudden, it's right on your back door. I didn't think I would make it. I didn't think my wife and kids would make it. I literally thought, oh lordy, lordy, here we go. You better get going. I turned to go, and as I turned to go, the refrigerator hit me first. I didn't think I'd see anybody again.
Our house!
The violent winds throw Chris around until his family, sheltering in the basement, risk their own lives to pull him to safety.
My stepson still swears to this day that he felt suction pulling me back out.
Hey. Come on. Hey. Hey, Chris, we're okay. Come on, guys.
Oh.
What happened, Chris?
Oh.
Chris, you get hit with?
I don't know.
Despite being battered by flying debris, Chris escapes with minor injuries.
My eyesight went a little bad. I lost 5% of vision in my right eye. Like a slight concussion is all I really got out of it. I'm like a cat with 9 lives. Can't take me down. I've lived 10 lives. I got an extra life somewhere.
As Chris shelters in the basement with his family, the tornado swiftly destroys their home above them.
This is what my house looks like after a tornado came through.
I seen a war zone. Houses, roofs, stoves, refrigerators, food, car, everything just mangled. Piles of debris everywhere. It looked like 9/11, you know, down there, ground zero. Just cry, man, just cry. That's all I could do. It's just amazing how people survived this.
6 months on from the tornado, Chris is renting a house nearby, whilst he and his neighbors slowly rebuild their homes and their community.
My daughter lost everything that she had as a baby. She's only 4 years old now, and she's lost all her baby good stuff. As you can see, she just found something out in the neighbor's yard. This is what stuff looks like that we're finding. Would you want your kids to have that every day? No. But would you want your kid to have something that is memories of what she had before she lost everything? Yes.
The tornado damaged almost 500 homes, as well as taking 6 lives. Chris knows just how close he came to losing his own.
I've seen something amazing that almost killed me.
Tropical cyclones, also known as hurricanes, form over warm ocean waters when the rising moist air cools to saturation, causing high winds and heavy rain. But the biggest threat to life when a hurricane makes landfall is the rise in sea levels or storm surge, flooding homes and cutting off escape routes. In October 2012, Hurricane Sandy struck New York City with such devastating force that it caused $18 billion worth of damage. In Breezy Point in Queens, residents were rocked by the elements as the superstorm brought fire and floods to the tiny oceanfront neighborhood.
I came within 3 minutes of being killed, and there was really nothing I could have done.
With advance warning of the hurricane, the area had been under evacuation orders, but some residents wanted to ride out the storm. Rosemary McGinn was one of them.
A lot of people have said to me, what, are you crazy? How could you stay? I love crazy, severe weather. I wanted to see what it was like, and it never occurred to me that there would be any danger.
But the storm would bring conditions that Rosemary had never experienced before, including winds of 80 miles per hour.
I actually had never seen wind like that here. But I think that was really the big mistake that everybody made, was to focus on the wind, when it was the water that really devastated everybody. It was raining hard. It feels like you're getting hit with knitting needles or something. I felt it on my face.
The rainfall, combined with a 13-foot tidal surge caused by Hurricane Sandy, was just the start of the problems for the coastal community.
It looks like the ocean is coming in. It doesn't look like a wave. It doesn't look like something is going to recede. I hear what sounds like an explosion in the basement. I come downstairs. I could see that water was up to about the third or fourth step. I went to the closet to get my wellies. I pull them on, and when I got back to the stairs, the water was almost to the top. And of course, I'm thinking, well, if the water got to the ceiling here in less than 5 minutes, maybe it'll get to that ceiling in less than 5 minutes. That just terrified me. And there's not, I'm going to be on the roof with looking for a helicopter. I really didn't know what to do.
With nightfall and no sign of the storm abating, Rosemary is a prisoner in her own home. There's nothing she can do but sit tight and hope for the best.
I get my cell phone and go to the front door and take video of the surge coming in. I had this thought. I'm going to die. This is amazing. I'm going to die here.
Half a mile away, there's an even greater threat to life in the tight-knit community. Chicle fire is raging out of control. The fire department of New York can offer only limited help, held at bay by the tidal surge.
Our fire trucks at the time are now under 5 feet of water. And across the main road, there was a very strong current. The firehouse understands now that there's nothing that they can do, that we have to watch the fire just burn.
This is Breezy Point during the hurricane. No FDNY, no volunteers for well over an hour. We got like a third alarm going here.
Helpless, James knows there is nothing he can do as he watches the fire spread to his own home.
My house was in the middle, and my mother and my aunt and my father and our neighbor are inside the house. The firemen are coming around to me telling me, you know, don't worry, it'll be okay, it'll work out. There wasn't anything you could tell me that they're conclusively alive at that point. Then as I walked closer and closer, I realized that I only had my foundation left in my basement. Like at the bottom of a barbecue, it's just cindering ashes, smoldering remains. I had this sense of numbness. I'm thinking now that there's nothing else I can do for them. They stayed in the house, they went to sleep, and they're all dead. The absolute lowest point in my life.
Across the neighborhood, Rosemary is contemplating her own fate.
While I was sitting there looking at the water, someone banged on the door. And it's the guy down the block who has 7 kids. I opened the door and start crying and what's gonna happen, what am I doing? And he said, don't worry, everything's okay. And then he says, can we just go upstairs and look out the window? But it's just all angry red over the horizon. Now, as far as I knew, the whole community could have burned down. It's hard to describe. I think I was in shock, really.
Overnight, the tidal surge recedes and fires are slowly brought under control. 111 properties have been completely destroyed. The following morning, and the damage caused by Hurricane Sandy can be seen in the cold light of day. Whilst many residents lose their homes, for James, there is at least some good news.
I had received a text from my aunt saying, we're sitting in the church, we're on the second floor, everyone's all right, you know, come over and help us out, give us some blankets. I went over and I hugged my mom. They said when they saw the fire, they immediately started packing up and they had maybe 10 minutes to get out of the house.
Across Breezy Point, residents are seeing their community as they've never seen it before. Broken and ravaged by the superstorm.
She's at the bay? Oh my God.
I'm in awe of what happened. I have never seen anything like that before.
Incredibly, only one fireman and 2 residents were injured during the storm. But Sandy had torn the community apart.
A lot of people have left, abandoned their homes. It's made me more fond of the beach and more willing to be here and do the work and commit what it is to be here. You didn't know what was going to happen that night. How do we know what's going to happen the next time?
Coming up on World's Worst Storms.
Hold on, Jim.
A seafaring family risk their lives as they battle against Hurricane Ivan.
Oh, shit.
It was alive and malevolent.
In 2004, Hurricane Ivan decimated large parts of the Caribbean and the southern United States. causing the loss of 121 lives.
Oh my God.
Sailor Corey Lunn survived this monster on board his parents' boat.
Every time I thought it couldn't get worse, it did. I became very afraid that our lives were in danger.
Corey and his parents have been sailing their whole lives.
My parents lived on a boat when I was born, and they took me out to sea when I was 13 days old. I've actually spent more of my life with my feet on the deck of a boat than on dry land, and I like it that way.
The Lunn's boat, Tainatura, was almost part of the family. They sold their house in 1994 to buy it, and had lived on it ever since.
The boat is like a living person. It's a family member that we care about deeply. We refer to it as a person.
But when the Lunns took their beloved boat on a trip to Grenada, they knew it wasn't going to be plain sailing, with Hurricane Ivan heading straight towards them.
The weather forecasts early on indicated that it was going to be likely to be a very strong storm. It looked like there was a very good chance it might hit Grenada, but we then made the decision to stay put.
Although a boat isn't necessarily the safest place to be in a hurricane, Corey and his parents' sailing experience made them confident they could weather the storm.
All right, here we are preparing for Hurricane Ivan. Got the decks pretty clear. 3 anchor lines, all the canvas stripped off that we can. We knew it was going to be a fight, but we really didn't think that it was going to be a fight for our lives.
This is where it was at 8 a.m. this morning on September 7th, 2004. And at 11 a.m., it is now at 11.8 by 60.2. So it's right here, heading west or northwest at 18 knots.
Likely possibility that the eye will go right over us.
It was genuinely scary.
Corey's driving us into it. It's been doing a perfect job.
And then the storm strikes. The boat's engine is running at full throttle just to maintain their position and avoid being blown onto the rocks.
It started in fitful gusts of wind that would sound like a slap against the side of the boat.
We think we're about a half an hour away from the eye.
It felt like the hurricane was a living thing. It was alive and malevolent. It felt like it was just toying with us. It was like, ha-ha, look what I can do. Look what I can do. And there's a lot more coming.
Okay, all right, we only went to the gunwale.
The boat was on its side more than it was upright. And it seemed like it just couldn't take any more. And then it did. And it just kept getting worse. Every time I thought it couldn't get worse, it did.
All right, hang on.
I became very afraid that our lives were in danger.
Okay. All right.
After hours of relentless fight, Corey and his parents lose the battle with the hurricane. When an unmanned boat hits them and smashes theirs against a cliff. Corey and his parents abandon the boat and head for dry land.
Okay.
Getting onto land was a massive relief. I literally climbed onto the dock on my hands and knees and laid there crying, bawling my eyes out.
Once the winds calm down, the damages to the boat are revealed. But the destruction on land is far greater.
Oh my God. Everybody was practically homeless overnight. Street after street, community after community, everything was gone. Whole communities of people with nothing but foundations left. And those were the lucky ones.
Looks like those houses exploded.
We'll be right back.
yearly tradition. So I bought tickets again to go to a country concert.
Unlike David, Jessica had gone for the cheaper seats in the sheltered grandstand away from the stage.
My mom was really happy with our seats because I knew that there was a chance of severe storms that they were predicting later in the day. And she was saying how happy she was that we got like the cheap seats.
At 8:39 p.m., just 6 minutes before the headline act was due to go on stage, the National Weather Service issued a severe thunderstorm warning for the area.
I was taking a lot of pictures of the storm approaching from the west, and it was just crazy how bright it was in the east, and then you turn and look in the west and it was pitch black. It was the most drastic change in color in the sky, light to dark, that I've ever seen. And you could just see that something was coming.
We didn't think it was going to be too bad since they still had, you know, stage crew up in the rigging to control the lighting. So we figured the show was going to go on, you know, rain or shine. And then Herman turned her and started pushing her into the back. You had people pushing on you, trying to get in front of you, and then you could look up in the eyes of the people in the grandstands, and you just knew what was behind you wasn't right. It was like being chased by a beast of some sort.
The stage started to lean, and then it just completely folded on itself. It was almost like a movie. It doesn't seem real because you just don't think that that can actually happen.
The strong winds had shifted concrete barriers used to anchor the stage rigging, causing the 32-ton structure to collapse. Narrowly missing David and his wife.
Oh my God!
It was like you felt the pressure of, you know, all the equipment and the weight coming at you. It was like it was making its own gust of wind.
With devastating consequences.
You never expect to go to the state fair and have something like that happen.
The Indiana State Fair has been held in Indianapolis for more than a century. Local resident David Wood has been coming to the fair his whole life.
I remember going as a young kid and, you know, with my mother, and we would go once or twice a year. But now that I've started my own family, we try to go several times. They usually have, you know, two or three good headliners there to play each year. In 2011, we went to the fair that evening to celebrate my wife's birthday. I got us the pit ticket so we could be as close as we could to the bands. Just wanting to see a big smile on her face when, you know, she was 5-10 feet away from her favorite, you know, band at the time.
Also at the concert that night was photographer Jessica Silas.
I had gone the previous year with my parents. They wanted to try and make it kind of...
Tonight on World's Worst Storms. Hurricane Sandy devastates a coastal community in New York.
I thought my parents were dead.
In Illinois.
It's coming toward us.
Get in the house.
A tornado tears a peaceful neighborhood to pieces.
I've seen something amazing that almost killed me.
A boating family are battered by Hurricane Ivan.
It was alive and malevolent.
And in Oklahoma, a Force 5 tornado rips through a school full of children.
I've never been so frightened in my whole life.
Created when a center of low pressure develops with a high pressure system surrounding it, storms can cause chaos with high winds, rain, and flooding.
Back porch.
From thunder and lightning to tornadoes and hurricanes, they can impact on human life when we least expect it.
Boom, it's right above you.
The wind, it definitely came out of nowhere. It was just all of a sudden just wind, a huge, huge gust of wind. It was painful because it was all the sand and dust and it was hitting us in the face, and people started screaming and pointing at it just because it was so out of nowhere.
Heard all the metal clanking and seeing the screen going back and forth and swaying around. But we planned on, you know, waiting it out to hold our good spot, because we knew if we went and stood under the grandstands until it passed, we probably wasn't going to get our prime location back. I pulled out the phone to start recording, then it seemed like a bigger blast came in and got all up under the stage equipment and the awning. At that moment, that's when I realized, you know, things were turning for the worst.
I kind of saw out of the corner of my eye the tarp on the top of the stage. It kind of came loose and it was flapping around, because I thought that was kind of weird.
I grabbed my wife by her arm.